Welcome to Stories from the NNI. I'm Lisa Friedersdorf, Director of the National Nanotechnology Coordination Office. Today, it's my pleasure to welcome Scott Van Epps, Assistant Professor of Emergency Medicine at the University of Michigan. Scott, thank you so much for joining us today. To get us started, can you tell us a little bit about how you got involved in nanotechnology?
It's a bit of a path, so I can't really decide on what I wanted to do all through sort of my training. I was very eclectic. I started off with chemical engineering and molecular biology. I ultimately wanted to go to medical school, and that's what I ended up doing, but the pathway there was a little roundabout. I actually wanted to be a biomedical engineer, but as an undergrad, that didn't exist. So I sort of created this own chemical engineering, molecular biology, sort of dual degree program. Went to medical school, decided to do an MD-PhD program, because again, I sort of was divided in what I wanted to do. Ultimately moved on and did biomedical engineering, but was doing vascular biomechanics. It was a lot of finite element analysis and fluid dynamics, and then sort of how that affected the biology for vascular disease. And I was very drawn to that sort of out of this, well, heart disease is the number one cause of death, and you know, it's the sort of biggest killer in the United States, and these sort of like very grandiose sort of terms that are easy to put at the top of your grant writing and papers and things like that. And then when it sort of came time to choose a medical specialty, I didn't really like the appropriate medical specialties for that line of research. I tried cardiology, I tried vascular surgery, and while I enjoyed doing those sort of topics, I didn't really like that practice of medicine so much. And actually ended up really falling in love with emergency medicine, mostly because of the sort of diversity of things that you do in the emergency department. And came to Michigan to do my residency and was drawn here mostly by a faculty member, John Younger, who was doing research in infectious diseases. And while he wasn't an engineer by training, he was an engineer by heart and sort of functioned like an engineer and was very interested in medical device infection, and specifically how bacteria sort of interface with abiotic materials and surfaces and sort of the difficulty in managing these clinically. And so he got me into the area of infectious diseases. And sort of the funny side of that was that I was sort of sad a little bit that I was moving away from, you know, heart disease, the sort of number one cause of death in the United States, only to find out that actually infectious diseases and sepsis has since eclipsed heart disease and cancer and all of those things. So I feel like I climbed back on top, at least sort of from that standpoint. But one of the things we got very interested in is this length scales over which bacteria sort of function, which are quite small. We were interested in Staphylococcus, which sort of has a range right around 600 nanometers in diameter, up to 800 nanometers. And so their world is in the nano world. And sort of what does the surface that they are in contact with? And that's sort of how I got involved in nanotechnology. Because of my background in both engineering and medicine, at this interface where I was taking things that many of my chemical engineering collaborators were bringing to me and sort of saying, well, how can this help in the infectious diseases world? One of my colleagues actually brought me this surface. It was nano-textured with these pillars and said, look, I don't think anything can stick to it, including bacteria, and actually bet me $20 that it would be anti-fouling for bacteria. And it only took us about a half an hour under the microscope to show that that wasn't true. And since then, we have been working in nanotechnology related to infectious diseases, which has gone well beyond just the surface itself and sort of nano-textured surfaces, but actually to the level of nanoparticles as antibiotics, or I like this term of nanobiotics for that, where we're sort of thinking about nanoparticles as antibiotic drugs. So it's narrowed right down on this small area of medical device infection, but then expanded very quickly out to where we can apply nanotechnology to the whole field of infectious diseases.
Wow, that's fascinating. And I think that looking at infectious disease, starting with medical devices, and that being a significant challenge in recovery, I'd like to follow up on a number of things that you mentioned, but let's start there. So are you looking at implants such as hip implants, knee implants, or devices such as pacemakers and stents? What is the type of medical device that you're using these strategies?
For me, it doesn't matter. I'm interested in all of the above. Areas where we've got sort of active research projects and animal modeling that we're doing have been more narrowed to things in the vascular space. Some of that's based on my experience in vascular disease. And so we've done things with vascular catheters, central venous catheters, dialysis catheters being one of the more common ones that's difficult to work with. I've done a little bit of work with pacemakers, pacemaker leads and wires, those kinds of things. We've been interested in heart valves, mostly on the mechanical heart valve sort of material, but also equally as problematic are the bioprosthetic valves as well. We haven't done a lot in the orthopedic area, although I've got a couple of collaborators now, and we're starting to sort of build up that particular application. And we've moved also into wound dressings, which aren't really devices, but it's an abiotic material that wounds get infected and they have bacteria in them. And so it sort of quickly translates to that area. But honestly, I'm willing and excited to work in any particular implanted device.
You mentioned wound dressings, and actually we've had some discussions with folks who are looking at nanoscale sensors for detecting infection, for instance, in burn victims, so that you wouldn't have to replace the bandage unless you were aware of an infection to prevent that discomfort of people who are recovering from severe burns. But with respect to catheters, and you mentioned a number of different types of devices, what are the nanotechnology-related strategies for preventing infection on these devices?
Yeah, so I actually think of it in two sort of broad scenarios. One of them is exactly what you said, prevention. And so we're interested in a material that prevents two different things. One is prevents the bacteria from actually binding to that surface. Most of the bacteria that we worry about have very specific tools and genetic mechanisms for attaching to plastics and metals like titaniums and things that we use all the time. And eventually, once they get bound to that, it's very hard to get them off. And it allows them to sort of evade the immune system and evade traditional antibiotics, which is different than antibiotic resistance. So it can be anywhere from preventing them from sticking or killing them once they stick, and that's on the surface itself. The sort of second broad category that we're very interested in is, or I guess I'm pessimistic that we'll ever find a material that is like perfect, that won't eventually sort of get fouled and become infected. And in that case, we're very worried about the fact that when it becomes infected, it's essentially difficult or impossible to get rid of. And the only solution is to remove the device. And if the device is life-sustaining, like a pacemaker or a heart valve, or even a dialysis catheter for that matter, removing that is a big deal. It's a big surgical intervention and sort of puts the person at risk and is very sort of lots of healthcare costs and things. In that case, we're looking for ways to treat the biofilm that grows on there in place. And so rather than the surface being the nanotechnology, it would be what nanotechnology do we apply to the biofilm that's already growing on an infected surface.
And what type of nanotechnology do you apply to these bacteria that are already on the surface?
Most recently, the material we've been working with is a graphene quantum dot. Very recent work we've done has shown that we can engineer these quantum dots to bind to very specific extracellular proteins from Staphylococcus aureus that allows them to have sort of very mature, very strong biofilms. And it does two things. It prevents this peptide. The peptide actually turns into an amyloid protein, which we can get into amyloid and other sort of particular topics. But it binds to this, prevents it from forming the amyloid, which makes the biofilm really, really strong. But it also binds to already formed amyloid and disassembles it, which then makes the biofilm disseminate. And so now the bacteria become more susceptible to traditional antibiotics.
So basically, you keep it from having that strong film, those biofilms that perpetuate infection, and then you can treat it with normal ways of treating it.
Correct. It makes the ways we normally treat infections much more effective.
So you mentioned in your opening remarks being at the interface. And that's where I think a lot of the most interesting things happen. And whether it's interface between materials or interface between disciplines, one of the things that we see in nanotechnology is this interdisciplinarity. Can you share your experience and maybe the makeup of your lab and where you see the disciplines coming together in your work?
Yeah, this is very much who I am. I've tried to make my niche not infectious diseases or nanoparticles per se, but rather living at this sort of interface between clinicians and engineers, chemists, microbiologists, and sort of being in the middle. And some of what I do is translate. We all speak English, but we all don't speak the same language, so to speak. And so this is a huge part of who I am as a researcher, is making sure we can all communicate with each other. And this has started to move into other areas like computational and machine learning things as we learn about this and try to incorporate them into my group. So I will tell you that in terms of interdisciplinary work, I have collaborations with folks in pharmacy, folks in chemical engineering, mechanical engineering, biophysics, microbiology, as well as in medical disciplines like pulmonary critical care and emergency medicine and pediatrics. So my collaborators sort of are across not just multiple departments, but multiple schools within the university. I have a graduate student who's in chemical engineering. I have a graduate student who's in macromolecular science and engineering. I have a graduate student who's in computational computer science. I've been on committees and co-advised students in biophysics. So it's a very diverse group. My lab staff has folks who are in microbiology, molecular biology, physics. I sort of actively try to find folks who are experts in things that we aren't experts in so that it complements the group rather than we're all sort of monolithic.
So you ended up doing both a PhD and an MD. For students that might be interested in following a career path similar to yours, what is your advice on taking that path?
I think if you want to practice medicine, I mean, there's really no way around it. You have to sort of get the MD and sort of practice medicine and do those things. And I think that for me, the MD and seeing patients, which I still do, I still work in our emergency department and in our critical care unit, it is the motivator. It's what wakes me up in the morning and gets me to really push hard on the science and stay up late writing the next grant or the next paper, seeing these things in reality. I think a lot of people ask the question, do I need to get a PhD to do research? The sort of broad answer to that question is not necessarily, but it takes specialized training, I think, to really dig deep in research. And one way or another, you will spend time learning how to do research and how to do science and how to think like a scientist and how to interpret data, how to come up with an experiment, how to design an experiment. And that process has to be done one way or another. And for me, the MD-PhD program was a perfect way to do that. I got a taste of medicine in the first couple of years. I had this engineering mindset, and so I knew I wanted to do biomedical engineering. But one of the things that really sort of drove me was that the questions had always circled back to the patient. I'm not sure I could have done it without an MD-PhD. I've met several, and I have many colleagues in medicine who are doing amazing research, but probably not at the sort of translational level that I do, where you know we're building things in the lab and then testing them and those kinds of things. I think it's very hard to do that without that specialized training. But if you're interested in medicine and biomedical research, most MD-PhD programs, if you get into them, it pays your medical school tuition. So that's not a subtle benefit from it.
No, that's a big motivator there. So I'd like to totally switch gears and talk about nanotechnology more broadly. Looking back, where do you think we've made the most progress? And looking forward, where do you think the most exciting possibilities lie?
I think we've been very diverse in the technologies to make nanoparticles or nanotechnology in general. And there's a lot of very fundamental research to create these materials, how to do it in a green or environmentally friendly way, how to reduce toxicity with it. And I think that has been amazing. And it has gotten us to where we are now. In healthcare, I think we've focused nanotechnology as carriers or delivery systems or targeting systems. I think that is probably the biggest successes that we've made in healthcare is that we've taken traditional drugs, and I think you see this a lot in cancer, where we've taken a cancer drug that has a lot of toxicity associated with it, and we packaged it in a nanomaterial, nano carrier particle material, and use that to help mitigate that toxicity and really target it to the cancer cell specifically, or deliver it to the right spot, and those kinds of things. And that has been, I think, probably our best success. What I'm most interested in and looking forward, and the thing that I think will probably be really the next level, in my opinion, in healthcare, particularly at the nanoparticle level, is considering a nanoparticle not as a delivery system or a vehicle, but rather the drug itself. And that's what our work has been done, whereas the nanoparticle is the thing that is acting. The amazing part of that is that it could be a dual function system where it is both targeting or delivering to the right spot and functioning rather than just providing a payload of a traditional organic chemistry pharmaceutical. And I think that's really where the next layer and future is, engineering nanoparticles to actually be the drug.
That's great. Well, I want to thank you for being here with us today. Do you have any closing thoughts that you'd like to share with our listeners?
If you're excited about this, find folks either like me or others. There are lots of us out there, and just come hang out with us. I think most of us always want more folks who are interested, and please keep asking questions. I think that's what keeps me going. And certainly if you're listening to this, you're probably already interested, but please keep asking questions and come search us out, and we'll work together.